für seine Leistung.
Alle zusammen auf 3, 1, 2, 3!
Jack Sparrow. Ich bin Captain Jack Sparrow.
Thank you. scoped it up, I painted it, I've added some creatures to it. So now I'm going to go in and I'm going to hit the play button. And I've been looking for about 5 minutes. I can hit the play button and I'm going to test out my changes. I'm going to jump right in. This is the world that we just built. We're now playing. When you get these tools, whether it's the final minutes of the game, you start using it, or using the beta that we have coming up in October, you'll be able to use them to create these levels. If you were to save this level and then upload it to the community, this is what someone else around the world would see if they downloaded your level and played it. You can see the camera on the right-hand side here to look around. Again, just the world that you created. I'm going to go over here and disturb these birds. You can see that they fly away. And then I'm going to go over here to this goblin and see what he does. So it looks like he's going to attack me. I'm going to attack back. I'm attacking. So you can see I can attack. I can shoot some fireballs. Shoot some fireballs. Do some jumping. All very, very cool. And so, again, at any point I can just jump in the world that I create. Video games are a very iterative process, so you need to be able to jump back and forth between building and testing at all times. At any point you can save your creation, upload it to the community, and show off what you've created. So you might be asking yourself, how did that just work? How did we just go right into the game? How were we able to hit test and it works? And the reason for this is that every object in the game has a brain. It's essentially a way of programming the objects in the world to have the behavior that you want them to have. So I'm going to go into the brain on the main character. And here, we see some very simple statements that are very powerful, that drive these behaviors. On the left-hand side, you'll see when. On the right-hand side, you'll see do. It's essentially cause and effect. When the left stick, do will move. When the A button is pressed, jump. When X is pressed, attack. And so, some of these characters come with default brains, things like the main hero that you place in the world, things like the goblin that is an enemy that you'd expect to attack you, things like birds that when they're disturbed, they're going to fly away. That is why all of these behaviors happen when I hit the play button. So, you notice that I had a camera that was behind me and it started following me around the world. To prove both how quickly it is to change styles of gameplay, I'm just going to jump in to the cameras, and instead of having a follow camera, I could put in any other camera I want. First person camera, fixed camera, boom camera. First person camera, I've modified it myself. I can go into the game now. And now all of a sudden, I'm in first person mode. No character. I've gone from third person adventurer to walking around in first person. So that's pretty cool, but there's something even cooler in my mind than just switching out one tile to change the type of camera that you have in the world. So this character came with a default brain, and a lot of things do, some of them don't. But what you can do is you can go to the brain gallery. And what the brain gallery is a collection of saved brains built by the community that you can use in your level. So if you go into a level and you see some really cool mechanic that you want to reuse in your level, you can pull down that brain and just use it. And so we brought some of them here with us today, which will demonstrate how quickly and easy it is to change the type of game you have. This is the first person shooter. If I put this first person shooter on the main character, it will turn instantly into a first person shooter. Same thing for a third person shooter or strafing or hoverfly. I'm going to go into first person shooter. And let's see what happens here when I now go back into the game. I now have a reticle. I can now move around and now I can start firing. It's a very fundamental of how a first-person shooter works, all in just a couple seconds by changing out a brain that someone else has already built. All very cool. And just as an example, to do this with the goblin, if I wanted to take the goblin, change out his brain, and make him a bird, those birds that you just saw, their behavior, the goblin will react very similarly now. First-person mode, we'll walk over here. Don't worry, I'm not going to shoot you, dude. Fly away. There he is, right there. He flew away. Just like a bird would, right? And there are a number of brains that we have here with us today, but there's also going to be an exponentially growing number of brains as the community grows and strives to help other people's work. what's really cool is that when you you are a part of this community, you can download those levels, you can remix them yourself, you can share them back up, you can pull down brains, use them at your own level. And the people that you take from, the levels that you remix, those people are going to get credit because they feel like that's important to this community. We don't want anyone feeling like someone is stealing something else. If you have a level that you think is really awesome, you can remix it, you can share it, and the person who built that level first will get credit. Which we think is a really good idea and really healthy for the community. So let's see here. So we've seen that you can, every object in the world has a brain. We've seen that we can pull down brains from the brain gallery and apply it to various different characters. What I'm going to do now, just to demonstrate how powerful these instances to use, is I'm going to create one from scratch. So I'm going to go ahead and delete my main character. And I can choose any number of objects in the world to make. So I'm going to go ahead and be a boulder. So here I am, a boulder. And I'm going to go into its brain. And just like you might expect, this rock, although it has a brain, doesn't have anything in its brain. It's completely empty. Because rocks don't really do anything in the real world, neither would this rock if you just place it in the world. However, I'm going to change it so we can actually become the rock. So I'm going to jump in here, camera, follow camera. Again, nothing on the wind side, so always have a follow camera. We're going to go in and we're going to add some controls. One left stick move. When the E button is pressed, we're going to jump. The character that you saw before, he had a fireball and he had some attack with his fist. The rock, he's going to have to damage a character when he bumps into him because he doesn't really have any means of attack as it currently stands. So I'm just going to say, when I bump, I'm just going to select the gauntlet. I'm going to damage. So this leads me to another area of that you can change about the characters. We just wrote a rank for this rock, which we'll see in a minute. It's totally functional will work. What I'm going to do now, though, is I'm going to go into its properties. And every object in the world has a brain, every object in the game has a properties. If you wanted to go in and change your rock to be really blue or really red, I guess you could do that. You can change that. We have a number of options there for changing the appearance. If you go into movement, you can see that you can change the movement speed, the acceleration, and the turn speed of every object in the world. Every object has a jump, fly, and swim that they'll abide by. Combat, everything can shoot and throw. Everything has hit points. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go and change the physics. I'm going to say physics is now tumbling. So if I had gone in before and hit play, you would have seen a rock that was just fixed moving around. Now it's going to be tumbling around. It's going to be a little bit more fun to play. Jump into play. See, I am now a rolling rock. I can jump. Oh, I didn't get him. He flew away because he's still a bird. But if I would have bumped into him, I would have given him some damage. So those are the artistic tools that we're going to give to you guys. We also have a very powerful, robust programming language that you can use to program various aspects of this world. Thank you.
man bis zu 4,50 Meter weiter im Raum sitzen kann und die Kamera erkennt euch immer noch.
We can zoom around our 3D model here just to see the actual modeling and capping from the sensor. Now, in addition to the raw feed, we also have a full 1080p color camera. This is great for communication scenarios, Skype, or frankly, if you just want to trash talk with your friends.
Das ist unsere High-Definition-Farbkamera. Die ist super, um zum Beispiel mit Freunden zu skypen. Vorher kannte man das über die Webcam, da hatte man noch nicht mehr drauf als Gesicht, Schulter und Brust vielleicht. Und diesmal funktioniert das so, dass wirklich das ganze Wohnzimmer zu sehen ist. Und dann auch noch in High-Definition.
Now many people also like to play in the dark, so Kinect also uses its IR sensor to provide night vision. This allows the Kinect sensor to be resilient to a bunch of different lighting conditions.
Hier geht es um unsere Nachtsichtkamera. Also im Grunde könntet ihr euch auch im Dunkeln hinsetzen und im Dunkeln zocken. Ihr müsst, wenn der Raum dunkel ist, auch nicht unbedingt Licht anmachen, damit die Kinect-Kamera euch erkennt. Das alles macht unsere Nachtsichtkamera.
So with the IR sensor plus the RGB sensor, we're able to be completely resilient. So you see, here's a flashlight. Various different lighting effects will distort the image, but all this is resilient to the night vision camera.
Also es ist so, dass die Kamera das Licht quasi ausgleicht. Er hat sich eben mit einer Taschenlampe ins Gesicht geleuchtet und man hat über die 3D-Kamera, über die Nachtsichtkamera, Entschuldigung, gesehen, dass sich da nichts tut. Allerdings auf der High-Definition-Kamera, da sieht man den Leuchtpunkt.
Those are the eyes of Kinect. And so with that data, we're able to do a lot of fun things to allow games to do new experiences. We're going to start out with skeletal tracking.
Optischen Sachen, die Kinect wahrnimmt. Jetzt gehen wir mal hin und gucken, wie das eigentlich so funktioniert.
So here we're still seeing the three of us in skeleton form, tracking 28 joints of the body. You can see arm movement, leg movement, whether we're bending our back or not, and where our head is pointing.
Hier seht ihr die Skelette, das ist alles präzisierter. Wenn ihr zum Beispiel mit den Schultern einmal zuckt, das nimmt die Kinect wahr. Also einmal mit den Schultern zucken, genau, oder ob ihr die Handflächen offen oder geschlossen habt. Das ist bei Spielen wie Climbing zum Beispiel sehr interessant.
In addition to skeletal tracking, we also model orientation. This allows games to understand the pivot of your arms, which leg direction your legs are facing, where your body's facing, or even where your head is pointing.
Hier geht es besonders um Rotation. Ihr kennt wahrscheinlich Spiele wie Bowling. Dazu, wenn du mal zum Beispiel deinen Arm ausstreckst, einmal ausstrecken und dann so drehen. Also die Kinect-Kamera kann wirklich sehen, das sieht man auch gerade bei mir, ich bin auch noch so halb im Bild, dass die Kamera erkennen kann, ob ich jetzt die Innenseite hochzeige oder die Vorderseite. Und das ist beim Bowling, da kann ich einen super Spin mitmachen oder beim Fußball kicken.
We can also apply a physics model to this data. This is muscle and force. Red shows where the force is currently being detected. Green shows where there's little force. So as we stand on one leg, you can see all the force in that one leg. Or if we jump, we can see the force released and then captured back as we land.
Bei Muscle and Force geht es vor allem um Muskeln und Kraft. Kinect erkennt, auf welches Bein ihr euer Gewicht verlagert. Das erkennt man an den Kreisen unten. Je roter die sind, desto mehr Kraft verlagert man auf diesen Punkt. Das hat noch einen weiteren Vorteil, das wird er uns jetzt weiter erklären.
We can also throw punches at the sensor.
Genau, das ist, was ich meinte. Und zwar beim Boxen geht es ja darum, ziemlich hart zuzuschlagen. Und was ihr machen könnt, ist euch nach hinten lehnen, die komplette Kraft auf dem hinteren Bein haben und dann einmal nach vorne umpunchen. Und je größer dieser weiße, transparente Punkt ist, desto härter war der Schlag. Versucht ruhig mal, so richtig einmal nach hinten und dann einen festen Schlag auf genauso, einen festen Schlag nach vorne. Perfekt.
Player info. Oh, I'm sorry. There's lots of fitness experiences. There's lots of fitness experiences where knowing your heart rate can really help provide great experience. Based upon tiny micro fluctuations in the cheek, we can detect heart. heart rate by looking at your microflushes that happen on your cheek as your heart is beating.
Das ist was ziemlich Abgefahrenes. Und zwar gibt es jede Menge Fitnessspiele für die Kinect. Und die Kinect kann hingehen und eure Herzfrequenz ermessen. Das macht sie mit einem Sensor. Und zwar funktioniert das so: jedes Mal, wenn euer Herz schlägt, pumpt es Blut durch euren Körper. Und anhand der Wangen, die flaschen quasi so ganz leicht auf. Das menschliche Auge ist das kaum zu, also gar nicht sichtbar. Aber die Kinect, dieser Sensor, der da drin ist, der kann das erkennen. Und ich finde das verdammt krass.
This is where we have player info. So it identifies the three of us. You can see that it's identified in chat because I've played on this console before. We're detecting expression between neutral and happy. If we're engaged with the activity, or if our mouth is open or closed. This allows games to know who's engaged, what their state may be during the course of the game.
So, zwei Sachen, und zwar, wie ihr wisst, kann man mit der Kinect kommunizieren, man kann Spiele darüber anwählen, und hier die Funktion erlaubt der Kinect und dem Spieler, anders. Und zwar, wenn du beispielsweise dich mit mir unterhältst, ja, dann erkennt die Kinect das. Dann weiß sie schon mal, du kannst ihr keine Anweisungen geben. Aber er beispielsweise, er schaut den Monitor an und das wird unter Engage erkannt. Also guck mal alle bei Engage. So, wenn du mich jetzt in Rot, wenn du mich anschaust, seht ihr, dass da Nein steht. Und sobald du wieder auf den Monitor schaust, erkennt die Kinect, dass du wieder mit ihr in Kontakt stehst, sozusagen.
We also have what we call our third thumbstick. So our controllers come with two thumbsticks, and many times gamers aren't necessarily sitting down, staying still. This is the most simple way we give input to game developers. Model all of body movement into just a simple thumbstick to augment the two thumbsticks on your controller.
Für manche Spiele, da müsst ihr euch ins Zeug legen, auch körperlich, beispielsweise in die Kurve legen oder so. Und damit ihr aber immer noch vom Spiel erkannt werdet, folgt die Kamera euch. Also du kannst jetzt beispielsweise mal in die Hocke gehen und du wirst sehen, dass die Kamera dir weiterhin folgt und immer noch dich als Person erkennt. Geh ruhig mal in die Hocke. Also einmal in die Hocke gehen, einmal runter, siehst du, und wieder hoch. Oh, jetzt fehl ich im Bild. Entschuldigung. Und die folgt dir halt die ganze Zeit.
Our basic demo. Next we can get six skeletons up on stage, so I can take three additional volunteers.
Okay, wir brauchen noch drei weitere Freiwillige. Wir würden gerne zeigen, wie viele Leute die Kinect-Kamera erfassen kann. Jetzt haben wir schon mal zwei. Einer noch? Du? Hoch? Einmal hoch, einfach nur daneben dran stellen. Noch ein bisschen zusammenrücken, vielleicht auch ein Stück nach hinten. Und dann sehen wir, dass die Kinect-Kamera bis zu sechs Leute erfassen kann. Und sie erfasst auch wirklich jedes Körperbild von euch.
es hier wartet, um endlich